videos about logistics become, the harder it is for me to come up with the beginning, so let's get straight to the point. We have come a long way from ancient Greece to the Napoleonic Wars, which we will talk about today. The previous video talked about the emergence of the system of magazines, fortified warehouses located along the road of the army. They emerged in France during the 30-year war. The next place to reform logistics was again France. The reason is simple enough, the French Revolution. When your country is in chaos and at war with more or less all its neighbors, you have no time to organize adequate supplies. So the magazine system collapsed and French logistics reverted to foraging. So when Napoleon was appointed to the Italian front, the army there was a sorry sight. The army could feed itself by looting, but weapons and uniforms could not be taken from the peasants, and the Italian front was of secondary importance to the Republican government, which only sent scraps of equipment, and even that looted in the process of corruption. When Napoleon was appointed commander in Italy, he did not yet have the authority to organize supplies, so he only stopped the corruption and put foraging on stream. This is where Napoleon's rapid maneuver tactics came into play. The swiftness of Napoleon's army, its sudden strikes even against a numerically superior enemy, were not a strategic concept, but a necessity, as the army was constantly on the verge of a logistical disaster. While in Italy, Napoleon paid no attention to the neutrality of the local cities and attacked indiscriminately, because he had only two options, war or famine. It was not only provisions that were taken out from the Italian villages, but also arms, jewelry and paintings. The Egyptian campaign uses the same method of foraging. On his return from Egypt, Napoleon seized power and became emperor, thereby gaining the necessary authority to create an already full-fledged supply system. In essence, he did not invent anything new. He simply revived magazines, but now that the French army had the experience of waging a quick foraging war, magazines were related to the background as an auxiliary system. Napoleon's next major campaign began at 1805, the French campaign into Austria. However, as soon as the Grand Army entered Bavaria, the system of magazines failed. And the further the French moved from their borders, the more they relied on plundering, and the more difficult the situation became. Thus, the Battle of Austerlitz arose. The French army had only a few days' supplies left, after which the army would have to starve, so Napoleon decided to attack the numerically superior combined forces of Austria and Russia. The Corsican won the battle, and immediately showed the art of diplomacy. As a result of negotiation with the Austrian Emperor Franz II, he was able to persuade Austria to capitulate, and supply the French army with everything it needed. Generally speaking, the tactics of feeding his army at someone else's expense had been used by Napoleon before, but this case is most telling. Had France refused to surrender and declare war to the end, Napoleon would have been in a very difficult position. He would have had to spend a lot of time foraging, which would have given Austria and Russia time to regroup and strike again. But Austrian Emperor played a double role at once. Not only did he supply up Napoleon's army, but he also convinced Russian Emperor Alexander that the war was lost and there was no point in counterattacking. This was followed by the Fourth Coalition defeat of Prussia, which shifted Napoleon's supply bases to the east, the Fifth Coalition, which resulted in Austria's defeat again, and the decisive year of 1812. Napoleon realized that the war with Russia would be difficult, so he began preparation for the campaign in 1810. Despite the fact that Russia and France were de jure allies. An army of 600,000 men had been organized, consisting of all nations that had been captured in previous years. Such a size of a single army was unattainable in Europe of the past, because it required too great an economic outlay. Such an army could not be fed by foraging even in Central Europe, let alone Russia, while the low population density would have stretched the force considerably. Napoleon also studied history. Before he invaded Russia, he studied the Swedish invasion of Russia during the Great Northern War. He learned about the Russian strategy of scorched earth, where retreating troops looted territories themselves to avoid leaving provisions for the enemy. Putting all these factors together, he realized that there was no point in trying to conquer Russia. The Russian army could simply retreat eastwards indefinitely, gradually overwhelming Napoleon. He decided that this very Russian army had to be destroyed in the border battles, without going deeper into enemy lands. That is why the Grand Army was so huge. It has to destroy the Russian army as quickly as possible, without letting it retreat, and to produce a psychological effect of a huge horde. To supply his army, Napoleon had set up stores of supplies in Poland and Eastern Germany. The supply center was the city of Gdańsk, which had its own warehouse capable of supplying the Grand Army for 50 days. The army also got a good old-fashioned wagon train, designed to ease the pressure on the magazines in the early days. All this was the biggest logistical operation of this time. From the very first day, the march did not go according to plan, as the heavy French wagons simply got bogged down in the Russian roads, and the transport had to be abandoned. The ration of horses had to be reduced, so that about a fifth of the horses starving to death at the start of the march. Napoleon also was thinking of scorched earth tactics, and the lack of foraging was not the decisive factor. But he did not think that the locals, deprived of food, would attack French transport coming from Gdansk. And this is how the French got to know with the Russian partisans. The final nail in the coffin of the French army was the failure of a plan to defeat the Russian army on the border. The commander of the Russian troops was Barclay de Tolly, a genius of slow retreat. He managed to save the Russian army and retreated to Smolensk, where he was forced to engage in a battle, which he lost of course, for which he was dismissed from the command. The new commander was Kutuzov, who gave the famous Battle of Borodino, where 130,000 men from both sides came together. The French won a Pyrrhic victory and took Moscow. When Kutuzov realized that Moscow would have to be surrendered, he said, "Well, I bring the damned French to it. They will eat horse meat." By the way, the French were already eating horse meat by that time, but never mind. Kutuzov managed to get all the provisions out of Moscow, so when Napoleon occupied the city, he found the warehouses empty. Later, the city was also set on fire. So, Napoleon sits in a burning Moscow in autumn, with no supplies. Initially, he did not want to take Moscow at all, he just pursued the Russian army, and the lack of supplies forced him to take the city. Going further did not make sense, because further away was the town of Perm, which was one of the strongest fortresses in Russia. And attacking St. Petersburg would have meant a winter campaign with a depleted army and Kutuzov in the rear. Napoleon therefore decided to play out the Austrian scenario. He claimed victory and invited Alexander to surrender. And here the system failed, as Alexander declared that he would eat potatoes in Siberia but would not surrender. Later Napoleon offered peace on terms of Lithuanian independence, to which Alexander simply did not respond. Still later, he asked for peace on any terms, and again he was ignored. All in all, Napoleon began to retreat and return to France with an army of 30,000 men, out of origin 600,000. Of course, not everyone was killed. For example, Prussian and Austrian units went over to the side of Russia. Napoleon's further adventures are logistically unremarkable. Don't forget to leave a like and join my Discord server, link in the description.